श्रीकृष्णचैतन्य प्रभुनित्यानन्द श्री अद्वैतगदाधर श्रीवासादिगौरभक्तवृन्द हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा राम राम हरे हरे एवरीबडी टुगेदर कृष्णा 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 हरे रामा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा राम राम हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्ण हरे राम हरे हरे कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे राम 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 हरे हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे राम हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे राम 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 हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा कृष्णा हरे हरे राम राम हरे कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा हरे 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 राम 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 हरे कृष्णा Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Hare Ram, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Jaya Prabhupada, 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 Srila Prabhupada. Hare Bol, Hare Bol, Hare Bol, Hare Bol. Kali Yuga Pavana Hari Nama Sankirtan Ki Ananta Koti Vaishnava Vrinda Ki Srila Prabhupada Ki నమో విష్ణుపాదాయ కృష్ణప్రేష్టాయ భూతలే శ్రీమతే భక్తివేదాంత స్వామినితి నామినే నమస్తే సారస్వతే దేవే గౌరవాణీ ప్రచారిణే నిర్విశేష శూన్యవాది పాశ్చాత్యదేశతారిణే వాంఛాకల్పతరుభ్యశ్చ కృపాసింధుభ్య ఏవ చ పతితానాం పావనేభ్యో వైష్ణవేభ్యో నమో నమః జయ శ్రీ కృష్ణ చైతన్య ప్రభు నిత్యానంద శ్రీ అద్వైత గదాధర శ్రీవాసాది గౌర భక్తవృంద హరే కృష్ణ 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 హరే 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 రామ 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 హరే హరే సో వి వెల్కమ్ ఆల్ ఆఫ్ యూ ఫర్ ద వెనస్డే ఈవినింగ్ సెషన్ From today, from this class onwards, I am starting the Sankalp Camp sessions. We have been doing this for the college youth in the last so many years. Now I am making it available for the congregation devotees as well. I have modified the notes with many quizzes and other activity sheets here. So, when one completes the Discover Yourself course, DYS, and comes to the Positive Thinker course, where you all finished about six sessions there, six more lessons, and now we are going to do this Sankalp in another probably about 10, 12 sessions or so, and this is the first one in it. We do it actually as a weekend camp, but since we all cannot gather together in a weekend, I am making it all as one session for you. And this is a very important session on can faith be reasonable. And in the last several classes, I came to know that many of you who are viewing the these sessions, you don't have a hard copy of the notes in front of you. For referring to the quizzes, some of them wrote to me back. We have been uploading the PDF file, but some haven't downloaded it. Some of them are watching in the WhatsApp. So keeping that in mind, we are making the notes also accessible to you on the screen. Hope you will be able to see it clearly. So this session is the turning point session, I can tell you. Because this is going to talk about blind faith and reasonable faith. You are taking to these classes very seriously. And I pray to the Lord that these classes are fruitful for you and you benefit immensely from these classes in a way that it helps you in your life to become a better individual, to become a devotee of God, to attain the ultimate perfection of human life. So as we put our forward steps, as we go ahead, we have to develop a very firm faith in whatever we are practicing. Therefore, we have this session on, can faith be reasonable? You see, in this world, we all put faith everywhere. Our faith begins with the breast milk given by the mother in whom we put faith. And eventually, as you grow up, you put faith in a man or a woman with whom you get married. There is a lot of risk involved. Still, we enter into marital relationship in this world, putting faith in someone, isn't it? Similarly, you put faith in a company which offers you a job. So, it is said in some countries which are very materialistic, when you go in the morning to the company, you can't be sure whether you'll have the job. And when you return in the evening, you can't be sure whether there'll be a wife at home. Still people join a job, still people marry. You can see when the WTC September 11 event had happened, when two planes had crashed into the Twin Towers in America. After that, for a week or so, there was very less air traffic. People feared that every plane will enter into some building. That's what they thought. But after 1 week, again people started normally traveling in planes. People eventually put faith. Similarly, I had gone to South India near NIT Suratkal. We have this Malpe beach. So I had taken a group of boys. They wanted to take a bath and then we had a class in the seashore. But surprisingly, we found on that day, hardly anybody was there. The beach was completely empty. And I asked the boys, what is the matter? They said, tsunami, which came in Sri Lanka, had only come 2 days ago. So now people are afraid to come near any of the beaches or the oceans. But after a week, what do you think happened? People started again coming to the sea beach. You will see in this world, people are forced to put faith in aeroplanes, in marriages, in hotels, in barbers, when they bring the knife close to your neck, just by pressing the knife 2 or 3 millimeters inside our throat, they can finish us. But we have faith that they won't do such a thing. We put faith in the barber. In this way, we all are putting faith. When you go to a hotel, you know that the food is proper food. It will not make you sick. You put faith. So, I told you many examples now of things in which we put faith. So now you may ask me, so what do you mean to say? You say that because we are putting faith in all these things, that put faith in God? No. I would say that this topic of faith is a very important topic and we have to analytically understand it. Some people claim that if you can show me God, then I will put faith in Him. Because I have not seen God creating this world. So if you can show Him to me, then I will believe. But let us ask a question to ourselves. Do you think, there are many things that we see with our eyes. Do you think we put faith in them? Think about it. For example, you see many advertisement in the billboards. They say, use this soap and you'll become happy. And you just laugh it off. There are many false things they say in advertisement. You see it, but you don't believe it, isn't it? Similarly, the railway lines appear to be converging at one point, and you know very well the railway lines are not converging. Hey, close the windows. And also, the mirage, which appears to be like a river, water, but when you go near the mirage, there is no water there. Although your eyes are showing you that there is some water, isn't it? There are many things that you see, like when you go to Kanyakumari, for example. When the sun is setting, it appears that the sun is going into the ocean. Is it going into the ocean? You know very well, it's not going into the ocean. You see with your eyes, still you don't believe it. Which means, there are many things you see with your eyes, but you know very well it is false. It's not true. You don't believe in them. And there are other things which you don't see, you know, but in which you put faith. For example, you have not seen X-rays, alpha rays, beta rays, gamma rays, positive rays. You don't see those things. You have not seen your great-grandfather, have you? Have you seen your grandfather's father or grandfather's grandfather? But you know that they existed. Therefore, your family line, Vamsha, is coming down. You have not seen them, but you have faith in them. Similarly, the TV news tells you many things which you have not seen with eyes, but you believe in it. It must have happened. Therefore, they are reading out the news, isn't it? So there are many things, even without seeing, we believe. Like you might not have gone to America, but one of your friends wrote G.R.E. Toffel and went to America, and they tell you, and you believe it, simply by hearing it. So if you are hearing a TV news, or if you are hearing from your friend and you are believing in it, can't we hear the Bhagavad Gita or Bhagavatam or Vedas and hear them and put faith in the words? So therefore we need to know how much faith is considered a reasonable faith and when is the faith considered as blind faith. That we have to see, isn't it? For example, say you have to go to a doctor. Now, how will you choose a doctor now? How will you choose a doctor? You are certainly going to consult some of your relatives who know the doctor well. And you will also check whether the doctor holds MBBS and IMD. Is he a qualified doctor? And you will also check whether he has cured the patients and saved them from deadly diseases, or many, many people went to him and they died. You will check that. Is he a very skilled doctor? You are not going to go to any quack and show your body. You are certainly going to go for a good doctor, isn't it? So, in this way, the faith has to be reasonable before you give your head or give before. Like you see that you want to go in a plane from India to America. Some particular airlines is taking from India to America. Many, many people have gone. Thousands of people have gone. So you put faith in the company and purchase a ticket. Similarly, you want to join engineering college. You know, you will certainly check whether the college has produced many meritorious students and they got placed in good jobs. Then you accept. So this is called reasonable faith. And verifiable part is the results. A doctor means you should have cured the patients. A college means you should have produced good results. In this way, you will check the results. So that is actually called reasonable faith. Now, why are we talking about this type of faith in this class today? There is a reason for it. As you see in our notes here, the very first thing. Why is our faith in a supreme God reasonable? You will see there are many things we all want in life. There are many things that we all are looking for in life. For example, we all want to find out a job and get our daily food, meet in our relatives and friends. We want an accommodation to live in. And people are searching for a good partner. And people want comfort and luxuries in life. And they want peace of mind. And they want enough money in their pocket. So we are all looking for it. But you will see in this world, there are many things that we encounter which we don't want in this world. For example, nobody wants quarrel, but there are quarrels in this world. Nobody wants accidents, there are accidents. Nobody wants diseases. Nobody wants old age. Nobody likes tensions, stresses. But this world throws day in and day out in our lives all these problems which we don't want. That means I told you two things now. There are things which you want, we don't get. There are things we don't want, but they are forced on them. Therefore, we are asking this question, questions like this. Why should I suffer? Why this world is created? Who am I? Why am I put here? Who is the cause of all causes? You know, what am I supposed to do to become happy forever? Can I be happy? Like you can see, there are saintly people practically with nothing. They are so joyful, so cheerful. India is a land of saints. You can see Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu dancing. You can see that. Similarly, you can see every state, you name a state, there are great saints. Like in Karnataka, there is Purandara Das. In Andhra Pradesh, there is Tyagaraja. Similarly, you will find in every part of our country, not only India, you go all over the world, you will see people who are godly, people who are saintly, they are so happy, so cheerful. Even though they are living in the same world as we are all living. So, we are curious to know, what is this world? Who has created this world? Why has he created? Is it possible for me to put a full stop to all my sufferings? And can I become happy? So, anyone who gets this type of queries, they are very fortunate. This is called Tattva Jignyasa. Any human being should ask. If you go to Vedanta Sutra, the first aphorism says, Atato Brahma Jignyasa. Now that you have got a human form of life, you should ask, how can I become happy? In fact, the Upanishads say this. They say, Uttishtatha, wake up, sleeping soul, it says. Jagrata, prapyavaran nibodhata. Accept the beautiful boon that you are getting in the human form of life. So, now I am presenting you an interesting example of three men. See, you'll see the photos here. Here is an Aboriginal man. Then there is a second man who is a European man. And there is a third one who is a wild-eyed man. Now, what these three people did, I will tell you. Once these three people are coming to New York City. And let us take first the Aboriginal man. When he came to New York City, he watched the city with tall skyscraper buildings, with broad roads, and very beautiful high-speed vehicles, cars, and communication systems, traffic control systems, and very nice construction, architectural marvels, Statue of Liberty, and all these things. So the Aboriginal man was shocked because he had always lived in a jungle. When he first time came into the New York City, when he saw all these things, he was surprised. So he then concluded, oh, all these beautiful tall towers, skyscraper buildings, and all these arrangements must have been existing always. Like in the forest, I have seen mountain ranges. Similarly, these buildings must be existing like those mountain ranges. And that's what he concluded on his own. That was his own wild guess. So, this is an example of blind faith. Because he has no awareness of such things existing. He has not seen at all. First time he is seeing. And he is just making an imagination on his own. So he just got bewildered. Then let's hear about the European man. He's an educated man. He's himself an engineer. He is placed in a very big company. Now from Europe, he is coming to New York. And now he is seeing the city for the first time. He has never been to America before. Now he is seeing that such tall buildings, such shopping complexes, such nice fine roads, there are smooth cars, and people passing by. So after he saw all these things, what is his conclusions? Now he is also making a guess. What is his guess? He says that, I have not seen this city constructed, but I can confidently say, he said, there must be some architects who designed the city. There certainly must have been civil engineers who erected these tall skyscraper buildings. There are surely companies in which all these cars are made. So he understood that there is a big intelligence that has gone into making this beautiful New York City. That was his conclusion. Now if you compare these two fellows, that Aboriginal man made a wild guess that this is like mountain slopes one after another, existing forever. Whereas the European man had also not seen who constructed the city, but he had the understanding, being an intelligent man, he understood that surely some architects and craftsmen have come together and put up the city. This is called reasonable faith. Now here is something interesting. You see, the third man, who is called the wild-eyed man, you can see, he's coming here. What the wild-eyed man told, the European man, when he landed in the Kennedy airport, this man said, sir, here is a book. Take this book and read it. I am going to tell you how this beautiful New York City came up. And the wild-eyed man said, in the Hudson Bay, there was an explosion. And there was a big smoke. And when all the smoke cleared and things settled, all these beautiful tall skyscraper buildings and shopping malls and shopping complexes and the roads and cars and everything stood in this place. That's what the wild eyed man said. So what do you think the European man thought? He thought he has gone nuts. He thought he is mad or he is silly. That's what he understood. See, here I am showing you the picture of a cell which is, according to scientists, more complex than New York City with all its complete telephone lines and electrical circuits and plumbing circuits, everything put together. One human cell is so highly complex. Now, such a cell, there are 30 trillion of these cells in a human body. Can you imagine? Not just one or two. Not only that, they all are functioning smoothly with amazing precision. And also, these cells have the ability to constantly regenerate themselves, which is not the case with any country. Even the biggest of the cities, they don't regenerate themselves. But the cells are given the ability to regenerate themselves. So, now, one New York City with its complexity could not have come just from a Hudson Bay explosion. So, what to speak of one cell, 30 trillion cells in one human being. Similarly, there are millions and there are 7 billion population of human beings. And then there are animals, then there are birds, and there are aquatics. There are different creatures, and all of them have their cells in their body. And such a highly complex cell, how can anyone imagine it to have come from an explosion, come by chance? So, that's the main point here. So, naturally, it's a reasonable faith, the concluding statement you can see, that it is the creation of an eminently intelligent, powerful and expert human being. You see, there are two views among the scientists. The atheistic scientists, they conclude that there must be some cause which we have not yet found out. We are still searching. When one book came out a few years ago, you know, called as God Delusion. The author who wrote the book, he said, why should we stop our scientific research and come to a conclusion that God created everything? There may be some other material cause which we may not be aware. Let us still research and find out. And then in London and other places in England, there were buses carrying a slogan by him, God probably is not there, just enjoy life. They put up like that. So, why are some atheistic people trying to deny God so that they can do whatever they want? They don't like, for example, if somebody denies the prime minister of a state and thinks that now I can drive the vehicle the way I want, now I can loot the money the way I want, I can live the life, eat, drink and be merry. So, later on another scientist came and wrote a book, Dawkins' Delusion. So Dawkins wrote a book, God Delusion, and he wrote Dawkins' Delusion. So in this way you will find those scientists like Einstein and others who are very confident that there is a great intelligence behind this universe, a very powerful, expert, supreme being behind this world. They have the reason. Because you will see, not only the cells are so highly complex, even our own human body you will see how amazingly it is designed. Like you see my eyebrows. These don't grow beyond this. Whereas the hair on the head grows very long so that it can beautify your hair in different styles. Imagine if this hair were to grow long, it will grow over my eyes and I can't see. Every time I will have to lift my hair to see the people. So it's God's design. Now some scientists may say, here is some enzymes which control the growth of this hair. That's all right. But why here the kind of enzymes allow the growth and here they don't allow the growth? That's what is called as design. Similarly, you can say if you want to eat food, first you see the food with the eyes. Is it fresh food? Then you smell it with the nose. You know whether it is in proper condition to eat. Then you put in the mouth, isn't it? Imagine if your eyes are here, you know, if your nose is in your belly and your mouth is behind, you have to show to eyes, showed the belly and put it behind, huh? Isn't it? But God, you see how He has designed the body, all the things, in, three in one He has kept. Huh? You can see with the eyes, smell with nose, put in the mouth immediately. That's also a design. So you can see the intelligent design everywhere in the God's creation. So just as New York City cannot be coming simply by an explosion, because we have no experience of any housing colonies coming by explosion. If a big bang caused the creation of the whole universe, at least a small bang should cause the housing colonies creation, isn't it? So even if there is a bang, some blast happening in Pune station, the first thing we will ask, who put the blast? Who is the terrorist? Who put the blast? We will ask. Similarly, even if there was a bang, we have to ask who created that bang and how can bang bring about order and not chaos, isn't it? Okay, now let's go to the activities. So you have to match the left side to the right side. For each of it, there may be more than one answers also. Now you can try to match them. The first one is wild-eyed man. Now find out from the right. See, A must be nut due to his unreasonable faith in Hudson Bay explosion. Yes, that's the correct answer. And find out from the rest of the answers, any other answer matches with the wild-eyed man. Yeah, Hutch is matching. You see, he has unreasonable faith for claiming city's origin from explosion. Okay, and the second question, European man. Now it's very easy for you. European man, there are three answers. Find out from the right side. B, which is thought that city must have been constructed by architects. Yeah, and G has reasonable faith, even without direct perception. Although European man didn't see the city constructed, he can understand due to reasonable faith. And I, yes. And the third question, aborigine man, find out. He thought it existed like a mountain range. Answer D. And E also, D and E, has blind faith due to his naive conclusion. Okay. And the fourth one, cells in the human body. Only one answer. Compared to New York City with telephone and circuits, okay? And fifth one, dharma. Only one answer. Yes. Dharma means inquiries on God, purpose of creation, and how to stop suffering. So, now let us develop the subject a little more. Now, only one thing we understood till now in this session today, that there is something called reasonable faith. And our faith in God is a reasonable faith. Because when we go to the garden, like our William Wordsworth said, millions of daffodils, I see millions of daffodils. He was charmed by the beauty of the daffodil's flower. See the sunflower. See the hibiscus, see the lotus, see the roses. It gives us a clue of God's heart. What kind of person he is. He must be having some aesthetic appeal or a sense of creativity. Similarly, see the six type of juices. The sweet, bitter, pungent, salt, sour, astringent. When you see these creations. And also he has given us all these items for our sustenance. Like the grains and the fruits and the cereals and spices, all these things. So we can see God's emotion in play in the nature, and we can also see his intelligence. Intelligence in play, like he must be having a mathematical intelligence, because Fibonacci, Archimedean spiral, which has the same values, scientists have found out that in a ocean wave, in a pineapple, in a sunflower, wherever there is spiral, it follows the same mathematical equation. which means God has a great brain. So the universe has sprung not from a big bang, but from a big brain. So that was the conclusion here as a reasonable faith. Now let us proceed further to the second section on how in this world not only we see dead matter, but we also see living beings in this world. You can see, this is a very important question to ask. Is this world a collision of atoms and molecules with no rhyme or, purpose? One has to ask this question, what is this world in which you are living in? Like, what do you think about your mother's love for you, father's love for you? Is it just some chemical secretion? Exchange of love with your near and dear ones? Because when science is putting probes in the body and checking when you exhibit certain emotions, certain chemical secrete in the body, is that all? Or the emotions have a higher meaning? For example, here we have shown a picture of a jar of a big vessel with a lot of gulab jamuns. Now you all know how the gulab jamuns taste. Let's ask an atheistic scientist, sir, can you describe what a gulab jamun is? He can tell you the gulab jamun is 2 inches in size, it's brown in color, it is porous, it is spherical in shape, it is soft in nature, it is floating in a liquid of viscosity this much. All that he can say. But he exactly cannot tell you what a gulab jamun is. He may take a vernier calipers and measure the size, or screw gauge or something like that. But he won't be able to tell you what a gulab jamun is until you pop one into your mouth. Which means, you can easily understand, when science talks about mechanistic approach, the mechanistic approach may be used for measurements and things like that, but it cannot talk about the human consciousness and emotions. For example, such a study by mechanistic science cannot tell you how beautiful a picture is, how fragrant the rose is, how tasty the gulab jamun is, and how enchanting or how joyful is it to hear some particular Hindustani music or Carnatic music. How wonderful it is. So even object identifying machines or any computer or any other device cannot tell you about such kinds of aesthetics, which is a subjective conscious experience of all of us. It can't tell you, because such a machine does not have soul in it. Here, you go back to your previous classes, we studied a lot about soul and body. So, body is also a machine, but in this bodily machine, there is an Atma, which has consciousness, who is the real experiencer of everything. Like, we appreciate beauty, we appreciate sweet sounds, we appreciate nice tastes, we appreciate, like in chill winter, you appreciate warm water to take bath. You feel it very nice. Similarly, in summer season, you like cold water bath, isn't it? Similarly, when you sit in a train, in a very comfortable coach, you feel luxurious. Or if you're going in a crowded train, you feel inconvenienced. So these feelings are possible only when the Atma is present in this bodily machine. So body is matter, but Atma is spirit. So therefore, you will see two great scientists, Thomas Huxley, said there is a third thing in the universe, which is consciousness, he said, which I can't see to be matter or force, he said. Similarly, Max Planck also said that the science, only with the understanding of matter, cannot resolve the mystery of life, because there is something beyond matter, which is spirit, soul, or Atma. Many scientists have spoken about it. So, now we all understand that there is matter, there is spirit. For example, this mic is matter, but this mic has been made by a spirit, soul, Atma, by manipulating the material elements. Similarly, this computer is matter, and it is made possible by some scientist manipulating the matter and creating the computer. That means matter can be manipulated by spirit, which means the spirit can control matter. It has ability. For example, you go to an airport. Once I saw a huge plane standing, Airbus, and one pilot walked towards the plane, and as soon as he boarded the plane took off. Just see, one tiny living entity is going to the cockpit in the plane, and the whole plane takes off. That means the aeroplane is matter, and it is activated by the spirit soul. Like you see, you might have seen this JCB, they call it, you know. It has like big machine hands. It digs the sand and it throws in another place. But behind that huge, gigantic hands, there's a small cabin inside which is sitting a spirit soul. There's a human being there. And he's pressing the buttons due to which it's able to dig the sand and put it. So behind every machine, there is a spirit soul to operate the machine and, you know, make things happen. Is it not true? So I've given you many examples. Like, say, you have a 1,000-page book to print out. You just go to the computer, open the book in the computer, and just give one printing command by pressing one button. Immediately in another room, it starts printing continuously, isn't it? And it may print 1,000 pages, but one spirit soul gave the command. Without the living being giving a command, the computer on its own cannot print it. So this is what we are talking. Now, we have spoken about two things, matter and spirit soul. But although matter can be controlled by spirit, the spirit is not the ultimate. We are all spirit souls, but we are not the ultimate. Above us, there is God, who is a controller of both matter and spirit. For example, I switch on the bulb here, it gets on. Now I switch off the bulb, it gets off. I can do it 20 times, and everybody is watching me doing it. Then people will think that I am the controller. When I control the switch, it's on. When I control the switch, it's off. But, dear friend, think about it. If electricity board makes a power cut, my switching on and off will be of no consequence. Is it not true? That means the electricity board is a superior controller than me and the switch. Correct? Similarly, in this world, you can see that we all have limited control and we don't have absolute control. Imagine our Indian cricket team is practicing cricket, playing cricket. Tomorrow, imagine there is a match. If one of them while practicing, you know, he has a fracture, either in the finger or in the leg, he got a fracture. But he wants to go for the match tomorrow. Can he play in the match with a broken leg? Can he set it right overnight? That means we all have our body, but the body is not in our control. We can go to doctor and repair it to some degree, but it is not completely in our control. There is a God, a supreme controller, who is the controller of matter and the spirit soul. That is the main point. So as you see in the picture here, Mother Durga Devi, she is folding her palms. She is a personified material energy. All matter in this world are constituents of Durga Mata. And she is folding her palm, and Lord Vishnu is glancing at her and he is ordering her, telling her, "Oh, Durga, my sister, now create grains, fruits, cereals, spices for my children, living beings. Create all of them. And also give them all bodies, these material bodies." So Durga Mata supplies materials for our Panchamahabhut, for the material bodies. So as you see here, Durga Mata is also material energy and we are spiritual energy. So now Durga Mata's elements, material elements are available. We can control to some degree. But ultimately we will see that if somebody misuses her resources, then Durga takes a trishul and punishes the people who misuse God's property in this world. That means matter, spirit, and there is supreme controller Lord Krishna beyond both. So in 9.10 Bhagavad Gita Lord Krishna says, "Maya adhyakshena prakritihi suyate sachara acharam." He says, "My dear Arjuna, I am the controller of the material nature. I order her and then she does all the work." Like that Lord Krishna says, the rising of the sun, the setting of the sun, rising of the moon, the blowing of the wind, and growing of the crops. He says, all these things are happening by my order, Lord Krishna is telling. Prabhupada gave a nice example. Like a man gets some four or five guests in his house, he immediately turns to the kitchen and gives a signal to his wife, and wife cooks some tiffin and brings it to the guests. Similarly, Lord Krishna gives a signal to Durga, and Durga immediately does all the work. So Now let's answer the quiz. You have to encircle the right answer. The first one, Thomas Huxley's statement. Find out, there are two answers here. It proves the presence of the soul, a non-material entity in this universe, okay? A. And another answer is, the second is wrong because spirit has not arisen from matter. Third is also wrong. So D is correct. There's a third thing in the universe, which is spirit beyond matter and force. Thomas Huxley said that. So A and D. Okay, you have to find the odd man out. A camera can click the picture of a beauty queen or a poor beggar, but not comment about her beauty or feel compassion. I told you about this. A camera cannot have emotion. See all the ABCD. There is one thing that stands out. See, A is a machine. C is also a device, AC device. And D is a video camera. But the B is the odd man out because a scientist can describe the Gulab Jamun because he's a spirit soul. In a scientist's body, there's Atma. And that's how B is odd man out. Okay? And who is a true master of science? The answer is one who knows what is matter, what is spirit, what is controller of both. So, which is the answer? C is the only answer. And then fourth question. Example of how we are tiny controller and God is supreme controller. All the answers look similar. Find out which is the one. There are two correct answers here. Yeah, A is one answer. And D is another answer. The Jiva is minute controller, God is supreme controller. Okay? So now you all understood this. In the first section, you understood activity one, you understood the reason. It's reasonable faith to understand there is a supreme creator who has created all this world with such intricate, complicated design of a cell in a human body or even the creation of this world. In the second activity, we understood three things: matter, spirit, and controller of both. Now let's go to activity three, the cosmic machine, which is nothing but the universe. See, in this universe, there are two energies of God. One is inferior energy, which means matter, and superior energy, which is spirit soul. So, regarding this, I have thoroughly explained to you how a machine cannot function without a spirit pressing the push button. Like no car can take off unless a human being, you know, puts the key and switches on the car. Now, some of the people may argue that there are nowadays cars with no driver, you know, the remote operated cars. But you can ask them, the remote operator is ultimately a living being. Without a living being behind a dead matter, the dead matter cannot move. We can confidently say that. So now we are talking about a Cadillac car or any kind of machine, big machine. But what about the universe, which is the biggest machine that human being has ever seen? In fact, we have not been able to fathom the entire universe. We know some details of this universe. So, now, the biggest question is this. Who is the operator of this big machine? So, the operator of the cosmos. Here Krishna says, Maya Adhyakshena Prakriti. I am the operator of this cosmos, Lord Krishna is telling. Now somebody may deny, like you see Krishna is speaking to Arjuna. He is telling Arjuna, my dear Arjuna, this whole universe is created by me, maintained by me and destroyed by me. Krishna says that. So if somebody says, no, 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 Krishna is not the operator, then they have to present an alternative solution to this. Who is the operator? Okay. Which energy cannot work independently? Please find out. The answer is inferior energy and material energy, A and B. Both are same only. It cannot work independently. Only spirit soul has to act on them. A and B. And then second question, the cosmic manifestation cannot work on its own as much as find out the answer. The answer is A, B and D. And the third question, out of the two, who is more important, machine or operator? The answer is B, operator is more important. Because how can the machine run without operating it, operating it. So, that's the only answer. For the third question, only B. And the fourth question, what do we infer when we apply this machine operator analogy to the universe? A is the correct answer. Universe is a cosmic machine and Lord Krishna is its operator. Maya adhyakshena prakriti, Krishna says that. The answer B is wrong because it says it operates itself. No machine can operate itself. And C also is wrong because it talks of some imaginary operator. And D is wrong because it is thinking of some shapeless, formless intelligence like CPU. No. Lord Krishna says he has a beautiful form and he is the father of the whole universe. And he is the creator, he is the maintainer, he is the operator. Therefore some people say God, G-O-D, means generator, operator, destroyer. So now you understood through the third activity about the cosmic machine, which is the universe, which is functioning very beautifully because there is an operator behind. You can compare the operator to a magnet, for example. In a magnet below the paper, if you move it, all the iron filings over it also keep moving, like ghosts, isn't it? How are they able to move? Because the magnet is moving it. Similarly, in this world, the sun is rising, sun is setting, moon is rising, seasons are changing, crops are growing, the flowers are blooming, the trees are laden with fruits, and the people are moving hither and thither. It's a lively universe. When Srila Prabhupada was in, London, he showed two houses. Look at this house, it is dead. The leaves have fallen on the rooftop and in the aisles. The garden is untrimmed. It's all dusty. And the cobwebs. Look at the other house. It's littered up. And the aisles are cleaned. And the grasses are trimmed nicely. So what is the difference between the two? Prabhupada asked. And then Prabhupada explained. Actually, the house which is well littered up and the aisles are cleaned and grasses are trimmed, that means some people are living there. And the other house, its cobwebs are there and leaves have fallen on the aisles way and also the grasses are untrimmed. He said nobody staying there. So in the same manner, look at this universe. Is it lively universe or a dead universe? It is lively because the God, like a magnet, is making everything move in this world. The operator behind the cosmic machine. That we understood till now. Now let's go to the last activity, very important. The remote cause, the immediate cause and ultimate cause. Look at the train picture here. You take any bogey which is moving. That bogey is moving. Why? The immediate cause of the movement of the bogey is the next bogey. And then if you see how is that bogey moving, then there are remote causes which are farther bogeys are moving. But the ultimate cause is the engine where a driver is sitting. is going continuously. You can see the driver is driving the engine and the engine is pulling all the bogies. So there is an immediate cause, there is a remote cause, an ultimate cause. Now why are we talking about this now? Because you will see the cause and effect principle in this world. Like I am drinking a glass of milk. So when I am drinking a glass of milk, now, where does the milk come from? The milk comes from the cow. Now, how the cow is able to give milk? Well, the cow is eating grass. Where is the grass coming from? Grass is coming due to the rains. Where are the rains coming from? Rains come from the clouds. Now, how did the clouds get so much water? The clouds got the water from the ocean. Now, how was the ocean water converted into clouds? That's because of the sun. Oh, sun, where did the sun come from? Then you come to the source of all existence, which is God ultimately, who is the creator of sun and moon, stars and planets, and all millions of living beings. So in this way, when you ask the question, there are immediate causes, remote causes, and ultimate cause behind everything. If we can know the ultimate cause behind everything, who is the creator, and he is the supreme controller, he is the supreme creator. Now, for example, when scientists see the vast oceans of water, they know it's H2O, hydrogen and oxygen combined. But they wonder, where has it come from? So much vast quantity of water. So they say this is all coming from the chemicals. But where did the chemicals come from? We can ask the question, isn't it? Such a vast quantity of chemical, not a little bit, not in the glass or anything. Such vast quantities, where have they come from? See, here we have shown the example of a lemon here. You can see the lemon comes in a lemon tree and you can see tons of citric acid is produced by a lemon tree. Hundreds and thousands of lemons come out. Because in that tree's body there is a spirit soul. As long as spirit soul is present, that tree is able to produce so much chemicals. That means living body is producing chemical. Like you sleep at night and your body produces some perspiration. Because we are tiny followers of God or tiny parts and parcels of God, we produce little bit of sweat. But when God wants to produce water from his body, he can produce vast oceans. Like, you know, we produce little water, God produces oceanic waters. We produce little chemical, God can produce oceanic amount of chemicals. Yeah. We can make a swimming pool, God can make oceans. We can make a dome light, God can make a moon. We can make a mercury light, God can make a sun. So we can make a small imitation of sun or moon, and God can make the real sun and moon. So in this way you will see, ultimately all these vast quantities of chemicals are coming from the biggest living entity, which is God. There is a source of everything, and Lord Krishna says that, Bijam mam sarvabhutanam vidhiparta sanatanam, he says. But Arjuna, I am the original seed of all existence, he says. Which means anything you take, say for example a banyan tree. One seed of banyan tree produces one big banyan tree. And that banyan tree showers hundreds and thousands of seeds. From each seed, one banyan tree can come. Have you seen a pomegranate? You open it, there are so many seeds. You throw the seeds in your garden and each of the seeds can turn into another pomegranate tree. In this way you will find in God's creation, the original seed was given by him. And that's what he says. Here, yes, you say here, see here, 14th chapter, 4th verse. We'll recite this verse. Please all of you repeat. Sarva yonishu kaunteya murtayas sambhavantiyaha Tasam Brahma Mahad Yonir Aham Bija Pradahapita. He says, all species of life are made possible by birth in this material nature, Arjuna, O son of Kunti. And I am the seed-giving father. I have put up a picture here with Krishna and all the different 8.4 million species of life. Isn't it? So each of these seeds can in turn produce another tree and millions of new seeds. Now recently I came to know, out of the 120 type of Indian breed cows, you know, only 30 are existing now. And the 90 varieties of breed are all extinct now, because human beings have killed them now. Not even a single variety of them is available. Now ask this question to yourself. If you want one of those extinct breeds of cow, can any scientist make it now? Can any biotechnology man can make it now? And if, of course, if we want any one of that lost variety, we have to go to Krishna and say, oh sir, you are the seed-giving father. Please give one seed of that cow so that we can develop more and more such cows. Similarly, imagine hypothetically that all the mango seeds in the entire universe are crushed and not even a single mango is available. And we all are very fond of mangoes, especially in summer season we eat. Assume that there are no mangoes at all. Now, can any scientist give you a mango or a mango seed? No, you have to go to God and say, please give us a mango seed. And once he gives you one seed, you can produce thousands of mangoes. Therefore, the Shastra say that Krishna is the cause of all causes. Now I am going to recite a verse which is not here, but you all can repeat after me. Ishvaraha Parama Krishna Satchidananda Vigraha Anadir Adir Govinda Sarva Karana Karanam. See, this verse says that Lord Krishna is actually Satchidananda Vigraha, which means he has a spiritual body and he has no beginning and he is the cause of everything. Sometimes people ask, if you say Krishna created everything, who created Krishna? And that question is very genuine, good question. Why? Because they have seen that our bodies are all created by our parents. And our parents are created by somebody. In this world, everybody is created. Therefore, they ask the question. But Lord Krishna exists beyond the time domain. This whole universe has it's a time domain where the time causes changes. Therefore, we all grow from childhood to boyhood to youth to old age. Whereas Krishna exists outside the time, in the spiritual plane, where he is always ever youthful, and he was never created, and he will never be destroyed. He is eternal, and he is the source of everyone and everything. Aham sarvasya prabhavo matta sarvam pravartate, he says that in Bhagavad Gita. I am the source of everything, he says. So, in this way, sarva karana karanam, it is said. He is the cause of all causes. Now, when it comes to scientists, they try to study only the immediate cause. There was one Dr. Benford. Srila Prabhupada was speaking to Mr. Benford. And Prabhupada asked Mr. Benford that, dear scientist, you see, there are two bulky volumes on the topic of grass. Study about the grass, protoplasm, cytoplasm, nucleus and all these things. But this cow doesn't need to read these two books to eat the grass. It just eats the grass and goes away. So for what is the purpose of, you know, studying such great research on the topic of this grass and publishing such books? So Dr. Benford said, only out of sheer interest, a curiosity to know about the things in this world that scientists do such research, he said. Then Prabhupada asked, why to research on grass? Why didn't you research on the person who put the grass here? Who has put the grass? Who has put you? Who has put me? Who has put the sun? Who has put the moon? Who has created this world? Because if you know the person who created this world, then you can go to him and ask, sir, what do you want me to do? How I can be happy? Why am I suffering? Like for example, a mother sometimes restricts a child. She doesn't allow the child to touch the knife. She doesn't allow the child to touch the fire. She doesn't allow the child to go to the balcony and peep outside. So she is putting some restrictions. And if the child is too naughty, not listening to the mother, she'll give a slap. Is it not true? So in the same manner in this world, we also see there are some restrictions put for us. People are trying to, you know, smoke and they get lung cancer. People are trying to chew tobacco and they get ulcers in the mouth. People are drinking liquor and getting liver cirrhosis. People want to not be satisfied with one wife, but they want to indulge with any number of women, and due to which they get several type of sexually transmitted diseases. So these punishments are kept because man is going in wrong directions. And if one studies the manual of God, which is like Bhagavad Gita, that will clearly tell us what God wants us to do, what God does not want us to do. And because He is the source of everyone and everything, whatever He says is all perfect. Now, because you are seeing the Vedas are becoming more and more recognized. Modern man is appreciating yoga, appreciating Vastu, he's appreciating astrology, he's appreciating pranayam, he is appreciating Ayurveda. Many foreigners are coming to India to learn more and more of the Vedic science. Vedas are time-tested knowledge, proven knowledge. Okay, so you will see that the scientists, they often research on the immediate cause, like the Benford was talking about the research on the grass. Or at the most, they may research a little bit about the remote cause, but when the scientists are searching after the original cause, the Vedas are giving perfect knowledge. Here is God, who is the source of everything. Accept it. But they won't accept it. They will still keep on researching. Like the Prabhupada says, this is the disease, he says. So, one atheistic scientist came to Prabhupada and he said, Swamiji, why do you criticize us? So, Prabhupada, why do you criticize that we are in ignorance? Prabhupada said, the knowledge that you have now, can you say it's all perfect? And the scientist said, no, it is more truer than the knowledge we had yesterday. Prabhupada said, so you, can you say this is the ultimate knowledge? Scientist said, no, I can't say that. Because tomorrow we may research and find out something better, which may be more truer than now. And then Prabhupada said, that means you are always in ignorance. What you knew yesterday, what you know today, what you will know tomorrow, none of them can be called as absolute. But if you want absolute knowledge, then you go to the Vedas. Like Vedas said, millions of years ago, plants have life. And Jagadish Chandra Bose recently proved plants have life. Vedas say, stool is impure, nobody should touch it. But cow dung is pure. Now scientists have proved cow dung to be, you know, antiseptic. It's very good. So Vedas give you absolute knowledge, he said. Therefore we accept the Vedas. Okay, let us do the quiz. An example for immediate, remote, an ultimate cause. The answers look similar, find out. The answer is A. The train bogey pulled by another bogey, further bogey and ultimately engine. The second one doesn't talk about the engine, so it's incomplete. B. And C doesn't talk about the question at all. Actually, the engine is the ultimate cause, but the immediate and remote are different, so D is also wrong. Only A is the only right answer. Then question number two, what do scientists study in the research labs? Which one is the answer? Find out. They mostly study only the immediate and remote cause. They don't study the ultimate cause. So answer is B. Okay. And question number three. An example to prove that scientists fail to search for the ultimate cause. So, where have they failed in their search for the ultimate cause? That means they have not understood God as a source. So, A is not the answer. What are they thinking to be the cause? B, seeing chemicals as a source. And C, seeing the cosmic manifestation to be functioning nicely without ultimate cause. Yeah. So, the scientists, the wrong conclusion is B and C. Okay. And question number four. What is the source of chemicals found in this universe? Yeah, first is correct. The immediate cause is of the chemicals is living entities like lemon trees or any other body, they produce chemicals, that's correct. And B is Supreme Lord is the ultimate cause of the tree that produces chemicals, correct. And C is everything is manifested and annihilated by original potency, perfect. C is also correct. A, B, C. D is not the answer. And let's go to the... So, A, B, C is the answer for 4. And the fifth question... Okay, I showed you these two verses before. And what is one thing that Lord Krishna says in common? The answer is B. This is there, the seed, original seed is there in both the verses. Bijam mam sarva bhutanam, vidhi partha sanatanam. And also, another verse I told you, sarva yonishi kaunte murte sambhavanti aha. So, he is the original seed of all existence. And you can also have answer A also, A and B. A is the source of all life forms, and he is the original seed of all existences. A and B. And sixth question, what is the disease of the atheistic scientists? Yeah, A is correct. and C is also correct. When Vedas declare, they don't accept it. They keep on still researching without coming to conclusion. A and C for question 6. So, now we are going to conclude our lecture with one very nice conversation between Srila Prabhupada and Bob Cohen. So, you have another mic with you? You can come. So this is Prabhupada's conversation on duty of a science teacher. It's from a book called Perfect Questions, Perfect Answers.
What is the proper duty of the teacher?
I will tell you what you have to do. you can listen to the dialogue now. And there is only one small question for you. In one sentence you have to say, there is only one weighty point that Prabhupada is emphasizing in this entire talk repeatedly. So if you listen to the tone of Prabhupada, you'll be able to know. There's a problem in connecting. Haribol. Yeah. So you can listen to Prabhupada. What Prabhupada is saying. At the end, let us see whether you can catch that one point what Prabhupada is trying to say.
Of a teacher in society. Let us say a science teacher. What should he be doing in the classroom?
Classroom? You should simply teach about Krishna.
He should not teach about...
No, that will include everything. His aim should be to know Krishna.
Can a scientist teach the science of combining acid and alkaline and this kind of science with Krishna as its object?
How can it be?
If you, when one studies science, one finds gentle tendencies of nature, and these gentle tendencies of nature point to a controlling force.
That I was explaining the other day. I asked one chemist whether according to chemical formulas, hydrogen and oxygen linked together become water. Do they not?
It's true.
Now, there is a vast amount of water in the Atlantic Ocean and Pacific Ocean. What quantity of chemicals was required?
How much?
Yes. How many tons?
Many.
So, who supplied it?
This was supplied by God.
Somebody must have supplied it.
Yes.
So, that is science. You can teach like that.
Should one bother teaching that if you combine acid and alkaline, they form a neutral?
The same thing. There are so many effervescents. So, who is performing it? Who is supplying the acid and alkaline?
So, this comes from the same source as the water.
Yes, you cannot manufacture water unless you have hydrogen and oxygen. So here is a vast, not only this Atlantic or Pacific, there are millions of planets and there are millions of Atlantic and Pacific oceans. So who created this water with hydrogen and oxygen? And how was it supplied? That is our question. Somebody must have supplied it. Otherwise, how has it come into existence?
But should it also be taught how you make water from hydrogen and oxygen? The procedure of burning them together, should this also be taught? That is, you burn hydrogen and oxygen together.
That is secondary. That is not very difficult. Just like Malati made this puri. So there is a flour and there is ghee and she made a puri. But unless there is ghee and flour, where is the chance of making a puri? In the Bhagavad Gita, there is a statement, this statement, water, earth, fire, air, fire, they are all my energies. What is your body? This external body, that is your energy. Do you know that? Your body is made of your energy. For example, I am eating.
Yes.
So I am creating some energy. and therefore my body is maintained.
Oh, I see.
So therefore, your body is made out of your energy.
But when you eat the food, there is energy from the sun in the food.
So I'm giving an example. I am creating some energy by digesting the food, and that is maintaining my body. If your energy supply is not proper, then your body becomes weak or unhealthy. Your body is made out of your own energy. Similarly, the gigantic cosmic body, the universe, is made of Krishna's energy. How can you deny it? As your body is made out of your energy, similarly the universal body must be made out of somebody's energy, and that is Krishna.
I'll have to think about it to follow that.
What is to follow? It is a fact. Your hair is growing daily. Why? Because you have some energy.
The energy I obtained from my food.
Somehow or other you have obtained that energy. And through that energy, your hair is growing. So if your body is manufactured by your energy, similarly the whole gigantic manifestation is made of God's energy. It is a fact. It is not your energy.
Yes. Oh, I see that.
Just like,
aren't the planets in this universe the sun's energy? A product of sun's energy?
Yes. But who produced the sun? That is Krishna's energy. Because it is heat. And Krishna says, Bhumi Rapo Analo Vayu. Heat, that is my energy. The sun is the representation of the heating energy of Krishna. It is not your energy. You cannot say the sun is made by me. But somebody must have made it. And Krishna says that he did. So we believe Krishna. Therefore we are Krishnaites. So in this way, it's a very beautiful dialogue. So I had asked a very simple quiz question to you. In this entire dialogue, what is the emphasis of Srila Prabhupada? If you see, you know, the other devotee was talking about mixing hydrogen and oxygen in the laboratory and producing water and showing children how to teach them chemistry or something. But Prabhupada said that is all secondary, but the primary thing is you have to teach the children that all these chemicals are coming from one personality, one supreme person who is God, whom we call as Krishna, the all-attractive supreme. That was what he was stressing on in this whole dialogue. But if somebody does not come to that cause of all causes, the ultimate cause, if you don't come to that point of developing firm faith that there is one supreme, there are many ways to develop that faith. There is one method called cosmological approach, which means your father, you have seen your grandfather, then he had a father. If you go up, whom do you think the person from whom everything originated? Is it a stone chunk? By explosion of the stone chunk, your great-grandfather came? It has to be a living person. And that living person is God, ultimately. This is called as cosmological approach. And then there is a teleological approach, which is actually based on intelligent design. Then there is a henological approach. Henological means, everywhere there is a group of people, there is one leader and followers. You will see that. For example, in a home, there is a father who is leading the home. In a school, there is a principal. In a college, there is a principal. In a state, there is a chief minister. In a country, there is a prime minister or a president. You will see that. As soon as there is a group, for example, in our body, there are many senses. But all of them are jointly serving one person, which is the belly. They all are serving. So there is singular supreme and plural subordinates. This is called henological approach. So similarly, we are finding millions of living beings in this world, and all of them are provided for food, clothing, shelter, everything. Then there must be a leader. Although the leader may not be visible to our eyes immediately, we know that there is a leader who is making this world run. In this way, we can come to the cause of all causes in various ways. There is an ontological approach, there is a cosmological approach, analogical approach, teleological approach, various ways to establish the understanding of God. Several scientists have come together and written a book called as Evidence of God in an Expanding Universe. Like a chemist or a physicist or a mathematician, from their own field they have established the presence of God through their subject. So now if somebody says, okay, all this is fine, but in case I don't accept God, you know, what is going to be a big loss in my life? I will just go on with my life, do my job, earn my money and everything. But you will see, people who are godless have no goal of life. They don't know why are they living. Initially, they want some things to enjoy. Want, want, want. Then they work, work, work. And they worry, worry, worry. And they weep, weep, weep. And they struggle their entire life and die one day. So think about it. Is that all the life is meant for? There has to be some purpose. And we all agree on a common point that we are looking for happiness, which is everlasting. The physical pleasures last only for a few minutes. Mental pleasures last a little longer. In this way, the Shastras say the spiritual pleasure that comes in connection with God is like oceanic, which all the devotees of God are experiencing. So if you are looking for such an happiness, then you are in the right direction of Tattva Jignasa. So another thing we can see, the uncontrolled senses of the human being is creating havoc in this world. Like I heard an interesting saying, lust makes men into monsters and women into witches. Because people become uncontrolled due to lust. And lust is a source of anger and greed also. Gandhi once said, there is enough in this world for everyone's need by God's grace. But there is not enough for one man's greed. So you can find one Hitler killed 10 million Jews. And like that, there are people who are causing great terror to the world due to their atheistic propensities. So, in this way, by denying God and living in darkness, we can cause trouble to ourselves and we can cause trouble to others also. In the same manner, we also, we do not know why we suffer in this world. But in the Srimad Bhagavatam, the reason is given. Janasya Krishnat Vimukasya Daivat Adharmashilasya Sudukkitasya Anugraha Yeha Charanti Nunam Bhutani Bhavyani Janardhanasya. It says, Janasya Krishnat Vimukasya means when human beings turn away from God, then what they become? Adharmashilasya, he says. They become Adharmashil. Janasya Krishnat Vimukasya Daivat Adharmashilasya. So when they become adharmis, then the result is Sudukkitasya, he says. They suffer. So this is a 3-point formula, it says. It says, first you turn away from God, you become irreligious, and the result is one becomes a sufferer, Sudukkitasya. And if you want to be happy, you have to reverse the formula. Instead of turning away from God, turn towards God. Walk towards God. Walk the divine path that leads you to God. And the result is, instead of Sudukkitasya, you will become sukhi, you will become happy. So, we are right now struggling with matter. We don't know how to truly experience happiness in life. We don't know why there are so many restrictions in this world. We do not know that. Just like a mother puts restrictions to children, God has put restrictions in our lives not to do the wrong things. So we are, but when you study the Bhagavad Gita, everything becomes crystal clear for you. So today, we discussed about the reasonable faith. Can faith be reasonable? So we explained to you very systematically and scientifically how the faith that we are putting in Krishna on the basis of Bhagavad Gita, as well as by our own, you know, observation in the world around us. Prabhupada's presentation is so logical and so scientific and so systematic, you can see that. Not only you have to accept the authority of Bhagavad Gita, but you can also see that how, really with our own eyes, when you see the world around us, we can come to this conclusion that behind this cosmic mission, there's the operator of the cosmic mission, which is God. And his ultimate cause, there may be some immediate or remote causes. And also, it's a reasonable faith. It is not like the some imagined faith or blind faith. So thank you all for your rapt attention. Now I can take some questions. If you have any queries, I can directly take in. They will raise the hand. They're sending the questions. Yeah. One question has come here from Mahalakshmi Mata. Here. Hare Krishna Prabhu, how can we know that a devotee went to spiritual world after leaving his body and he has not taken another birth? In the case of Tukaram, when thousands of people watched Tukaram boarding a Vaikuntha airplane in a place called Dehu, which is not far from Pune. So sometimes the Lord reveals it to the world. And they saw him flying. He told everybody, Amhi jato am chagava Rama Rama Nama Gyava. He said, oh, all of you people, you know, Ram Ram, he told everybody, now I am going back to Godhead. I am going back home, back to Godhead. That is the case of some people. Even Dhruva Maharaj was going back to Godhead. Even Prithu and Archie were flying back to Godhead, all people saw. And Ajamila flew back to Godhead in a Vaikuntha airplane. And in case we didn't find Vaikuntha airplane coming to pick up somebody, from the lifestyle of the devotee, you can say that a devotee is going back or not. See, Srila Prabhupada, you know, is there anybody beyond the age of 70 having a couple of heart attacks in a Jaladuta ship, you know, who stayed in America and preached for 12 years, who was so cheerful, so joyful, was 24/7 Krishna conscious, isn't it? So, from a person's pure lifestyle and from their dedication, from their joy, from their ability to reach out Krishna to other suffering souls and bringing about such a mass transformation in the hearts of misguided civilization. When Prabhupada went to West, he told, look at your boys and girls, they are all turning into hippies. They don't listen to the government, they don't listen to teachers, they don't listen to parents, and they are not giving up bad habits, they are smoking, drinking, drugs and everything. And Prabhupada told them, chant Hare Krishna and give up the bad habits. They immediately obeyed Prabhupada. And not just one or two of them, hundreds and thousands of them. Prabhupada had 5,000 disciples. All obeyed him. They gave up all bad habits. From that we can know that he is empowered by the Lord. So, there are three tips for you to check whether you are advancing in spiritual life towards back to Godhead. When you are chanting Hare Krishna, attending these classes, you will develop a taste. Just like when you are hungry, you eat food, you get taste in the tongue, satisfaction in the belly, and strength in the shoulders. Similarly, when you take to spiritual life, you will have taste while chanting and taking the deity darshan, studying the scriptures and all that. Then you will get satisfaction in the belly, means our hankering for material enjoyment will be finished. We will not be chasing after, you know, watching movies, enjoying in parties, all kinds of dirty habits and everything, we will give up. And we will get the strength to preach. We will want to share about Krishna with others also. So that is, these are the three symptoms given. From Nagasai Vikash Kuntala, there is a question. What makes Krishna extremely satisfied? From Kaliya, what makes Krishna extremely satisfied? Actually, if Krishna sees that you are aligning with his teachings and following his path, he becomes satisfied. You ask any parents, and they want their children to align with them so that their child will not face any danger. Similarly, Krishna is our supreme parent. If you simply align with him and do what he says, he'll be very happy. Arjuna said, Karishye Vachanam Tava, and Krishna became happy. Another question from Kaliya Krishna Das Prabhu. Man is creating hybrid vegetables and fruits. What about test tube babies, broiler chickens? See, test tube baby doesn't mean a baby is born from the test tube. One big doctorate man from Calcutta told me, test tube baby means they take the egg from the woman and they take the semen from the man, and they fuse both of them in a test tube. After fusing both of them, they put it into a woman's womb, where the child is born just like any other normal child. And that's what they call as a test tube baby. Nothing wonder. Whatever God is doing, the same thing they are copying. Instead of making the egg and the semen meet in the womb of the woman, they are making the arrangement for uniting it in a test tube. That's the only difference. And as far as creating hybrid vegetables, and fruits and all, we all know very well when man goes for such things, for example, the hybrid flowers like the gerbera, it has no fragrance at all, although it looks very beautiful. And also shastras talk about hybrids. For example, you can have a hybrid of donkey and a horse. It's called mule. Ravana's Pushpaka Viman was drawn by a mule, which is a combination of horse and donkey. Not only that, shastras talk about hybrids which modern man doesn't know yet. For example, Takshaka is a snake, but he also has wings to fly also. It's a flying snake. But modern man has no idea of how to unite and make a hybrid of a snake and a bird. He doesn't know. Eventually, he may probably do that. Only if man creates that snake bird, then we will see the snakes flying and coming to us through the windows. So the point is, many of these things are already mentioned in the scriptures. Okay. Then we have, again, Konatala has another question. How to offer bhoga to Lord Krishna when we are not at puja room or photo of Krishna is unavailable? Currently, I am chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra and eating. Is it right? Yes. You can actually close your eyes and meditate on the form of Krishna and you can offer also. One of the eight ways of making Krishna's deity is with the mind also. You can think about the Lord's form in the mind. And you can chant Hare Krishna and offer it. Then another question here by same devotee. Brahmanas in temple say that we must offer some rice, grains, etc. to avoid graha dosha or shani dosha. So if you are chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, is this enough and avoid doing all those things? Yeah. In this day and age, many of the Vedic procedures are not known. And the chanting of Hare Krishna, sakalam karoti nishchidram, anusankirtanam tava, Bhagavatam says, chant Hare Krishna and everything will be taken care of. We have a devotee, Bipin Bihari Prabhu from Noida. What is the problem with the blind faith if conclusion of both reasonable faith and blind faith is same? Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Okay, he is asking, problem with blind faith is, for example, if somebody blindly believes in Krishna, for example, and he starts chanting Hare Krishna, one day suddenly some problem comes in his life. Say he got a poor mark in his academics, or his wife divorced and ran away or something. Then suddenly he will say, why this Krishna did this to me? He may give up all chanting Hare Krishna and he may think that I put faith in Krishna and he did this to me and he may go away. You understand, no? But reasonable faith means you understand actually these are all small occurrences in our life. Somebody may have small failures in life, but God is actually the operator behind the cosmic machine. And he is the source of all the 8.4 million species of life. So a sound and deep understanding of the truth like we were doing today will put a very solid foundation. Just like when you build a building, what do? First you make a foundation first, then you erect the building. So we should have a reasonable faith and a deep-rooted faith which cannot be shaken by the small storms, you know, or the small and big storms that may come in our life. So therefore we need to lay a foundation of reasonable faith. We know Krishna is the cause of all causes, but we forget sometimes at that time. What should we do to again recall Krishna? One of the easiest ways to always recall Krishna is to regularly hear lectures. Nowadays, Prabhupada's all lectures are available in a particular type of machine. In Salem, you will get it. So, this machine has any particular lecture number you want, you press the number, immediately you get that lecture. So, I would suggest that every day you hear 2-3 lectures of Prabhupada, 20 minutes, half an hour he speaks, then we will never forget Krishna at all, because Prabhupada keeps reminding us about Krishna in all his lectures. So these are the questions I got today. I answered them, and like Bipin Bihari Prabhu asked questions relating to the topic today, I'll be very thankful if all of you who ask me questions after the class ask me in relation to the notes that I supply every time from that particular note, so that we cover questions pertaining to the topic. And that would be very helpful for our audience also. Hare Krishna, thank you. Now we will do Kirtan 5 minutes, okay? Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Everybody together. Krishna Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna Hare Hare. Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Krishna Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna Hare Hare. Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama Hare Rama Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna Hare Rama Hare Rama Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Krishna Hare Rama Hare Rama Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama Hare Rama Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare. Prabhupada Jaya Prabhupada Prabhupada Srila Prabhupada. Prabhupada Gurudeva Jaya Gurudeva Gurudeva Srila Gurudeva Gurudeva Jaya. Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Nittai Gaura, Hari Bol. Kali Yuga Pavana Hari Nama Sankirtana Ki, Ananta Koti Vaishnava Vrinda Ki. Thank you very much.